In 2002, on a pleasant summer day in Maine, a particle physicist named John Huth was on vacation. He didn't have much experience on the water, but rented a kayak on a whim.
I was kayaking around the island again, and a fog bank started to roll in, and I realized that I didn't have a compass or any way of orienting myself at that point, and there was an open ocean that was just off to one side.
With no map and unable to see the shore or the sun, John had to rely on his knowledge of physics to guide him back to shore. He used clues from the wind and waves to paddle back into the bay, grateful to be back to shore safely. This simple act of finding his way home sparked a fascination with traditional wayfinding methods.
I became rather obsessed getting back to kind of thinking like a physicist.
This eventually led him to the people of the Marshall Islands, who documented oceanic wave systems completely unknown to Western science. Huth's collaboration with traditional navigators would lead physicists and navigators alike to understand ocean waves more deeply than ever before. Before we get to the Marshall Islands, I have to backtrack, because that foggy paddle around the bay wasn't John's only memorable kayaking experience. 1 year after his 2002 kayaking adventure, John took to the waters again, but this time he noted the wind direction and coastline shape before setting off. When the fog unexpectedly rolled in again, he used the wind as a natural compass to lead him back to shore. But that wasn't true for everyone else on the water that day.
And it wasn't until the next day when I went out paddling where the harbor master caught up with me in his boat. That was when I learned that basically at the exact same time that I launched my kayaks, only half a mile down the beach, two young women had launched their kayaks and they never got back. And I was floored with what I can only surmise was survivor's guilt.
The physics that had saved him, but not others, wouldn't leave his mind. He wanted to understand the ways that people can navigate using only nature's cues.
It sort of opened up the world to me, whereas I felt before I was kind of isolated in some sense from the world around me. And now all of a sudden at my scale, my human scale, I was getting sort of the same signs from nature that I also sought in particle physics.
Through his obsession with traditional navigation practices, he learned about wayfinding traditions in the Pacific Islands, including the Marshallese people and the stick charts they use to navigate the oceans. The Marshall Islands are a cluster of tiny islands in the northern part of the Pacific Ocean. They're home to the Marshallese people, who arrived in the islands from Southeast Asia roughly 4,000 years ago. We know that's where they came from by studying their language. Marshallese is part of the Austronesian family of languages, spoken by people in places like Malaysia, Taiwan, the Philippines, and Fiji. Because the islands are so tiny, the people living there had to rely on trade to supply their villages. But the islands are also very spread out, making that trade challenging. They're spread across 750,000 square miles, and they're pretty flat, so they can be hard to spot from far away. If you're trying to get from one island to the next, you'd be sailing blind, basically until you ran ashore. That's why the Marshallese people became incredibly skilled navigators. Their boats carried 40 to 50 people at a time, bringing supplies to trade with the people on other islands. And the navigators had to be experts on everything ocean, earning prestigious positions in the community. Their navigational knowledge was privileged and passed down generationally. Over the centuries, navigators, or remetos, built up an understanding of the ocean so precise that it allowed them to navigate without any guides other than the stars and the waves. They created charts from palm fronds tied together with coconut fibers. Most of them were small, but they contained a ton of information. A simple chart could represent details about the winds, waves, and currents surrounding an island. And larger charts, called rebolib, could depict the entire archipelago. Because of how hard it was to become a master navigator, there aren't many people who can read these stick charts. In some cases, only the maker knew what they meant.
Unfortunately, this is a problem that, you know, a lot of the traditional navigators are gone because they weren't able to pass on their knowledge.
These charts fascinated Huth, and not just because of their mystery. Part of his interest came from the nature of water itself, because water waves are incredibly hard for physicists to study. In general, physicists are good at studying waves, from light to sound to gravitational waves. And there are a few fundamentals that are true for almost all waves. For instance, most of the time, the size of a wave doesn't impact its speed through a medium. But in water, bigger waves also move faster, so they're already harder to fully model than waves in other mediums. And things like water depth or salinity alter how waves move through the water.
Although we know the equations that sort of describe them, we can't solve those equations. And those fluid dynamic equations are kind of notorious to mathematicians of being at least so far unsolvable. And we can resort to computer simulations, we can resort to approximations.
When you add islands to the equation, the complexity gets dialed up to 11. Waves bounce or refract off islands and shores, and two overlapping waves can either cancel each other out or amplify them both. The results are complex patterns of wave interference around and between islands. While physicists are still wrapping their heads around these complex water wave rules, Marshallese navigators have a deep understanding of waves, which is the key to their navigational prowess. So a team of researchers partnered with master navigator Captain Corent Joel to study the science behind the wave piloting tradition. To map the complicated patterns of ocean swells, researchers deployed buoys to measure the height, frequency, and direction of waves. Joel chose the location of the buoys based on the wave patterns at those points. Then, Joel showed the researchers that the best way to sense these wave patterns is to feel them. Marshallese wave piloters are taught to lay in the bottom of their boat with their eyes closed to better sense the waves. And Joel could detect some swells that were too faint for research buoys to pick up, and used what he felt to reorient their ship towards the shore. Part of what Joel was picking up on was the different wavelengths coming at their boat. Short, choppy waves don't tell you much about the location of land, but long wavelengths are more reliably reflected off the shore. So identifying the direction of long wavelength swells can tell you where there's land ho. Many of the factors that contribute to waves, like winds and currents, are really consistent throughout the year as well. So although the exact waves will differ day by day, reliable wave patterns emerge.
But you kind of have to know what to look for, which is the challenge, just knowing what to look for. And that's what I believe the Marshall Islanders were able to do.
And they encode all of this knowledge in their stick charts. There are two basic kinds of charts, meadow and mattang. Meadow are fairly similar to traditional maps that we use in the Western world. Straight lines indicate potential routes for the boats, and shells mark islands. These maps aren't to scale, and are more about the vibes and general positioning of islands relative to each other, not the exact distances. But the second kind of chart, mattang, is even more interesting. These charts don't depict trade routes or island locations. Instead, they represent stable patterns formed by swells, winds, and wave interference around an atoll or an island. Curved stripes indicate the direction of ocean swells as they are deflected by land. The intersection of curved stripes indicates confused seas, where waves come from multiple directions at once. So when navigators encounter these specific wave conditions, they immediately understand their orientation to land, even if they can't see it. It's like if you're walking down the street and start to smell pastries. Even if you can't see the bakery, you can bet there's one nearby. These charts are a powerful tool for training navigators because they demonstrate general ocean movements, like how waves bounce off of land or different water depths. But these charts were very fragile, so navigators wouldn't even bring them along. They memorized them and left them at home because they knew how to recognize all of the elements marked in the charts just by the water's movements and the weather. Maybe you can imagine why becoming a master navigator can take decades. After Huth visited the Marshall Islands and began learning about their navigation culture, he was interested in comparing stick chart knowledge to physics simulations.
And so what I did was I got a hold of one of these simulators, and you can put in anything you want, and it's usually just some big, like a round object. But I took a map of the Marshall Islands, and I laboriously drew out all of the, you know, the Marshall Islands, you know, all the atolls and the places they were in, and then had a big trade wind swell coming in from the east. And then there were all these weird patterns that got created in the simulation.
The data gathered by research buoys and simulations like the one Huth built confirmed ocean patterns that Marshallese navigators had known for centuries. It even revealed wave features that researchers had never known were possible.
As far as I'm aware, all of the salient features that I know of in the simulations are reproduced, with the one exception of this thing called drillib, which, according to the descriptions of Corent and others, it's this disturbed passage of waves that connects pairs of islands.
Even though it's common in stick charts, the drillip motif is still hard for researchers to simulate. So it's another thing that Marshallese traditional knowledge has a better handle on than the high-tech physics experiments. Some Marshall Islanders, including Captain Joel, hoped that the physicist could help their community. Given that wave piloting is passed down directly from teachers to their students and without a written curriculum, some knowledge can be lost or inconsistent between teachers. And much of that knowledge transfer was interrupted by colonization in the region. The islands were first claimed by Germany in 1886, and control of the islands was traded between other foreign colonizer governments until they gained their independence in 1986, a process which took nearly 20 years. And while under U.S. control in the 40s and 50s, dozens of nuclear tests were conducted on islands in the area. Like, if you've heard of Bikini Atoll, that's part of the Marshall Islands. The people who'd lived there before the nuclear tests were forced to leave by the U.S. government. Many of the islands where nuclear weapons were tested still can't be occupied by people. So between the people who were forcibly removed from their homes and those who were poisoned with radioactive fallout, wayfinding has become a threatened art form. But the community hasn't given up on wayfinding. In 1989, Alson Kellen, a navigator and advocate, launched a program to teach young Marshallese traditional skills, including wave piloting and canoe building, to preserve wayfinding traditions and culture. Plus, through measurements and simulations, physicists have started trying to translate stick chart motifs into physics jargon and equations, decoding the wave knowledge they hold. Unfortunately, life in the Marshall Islands is becoming increasingly precarious, even without the nuclear weapons. Sea level rise has led to catastrophic flooding, destroying homes, roads, and crops. These threats to their physical space make it urgent to preserve their cultural and traditional knowledge. Stick chart navigation developed in response to the needs of the Marshallese people at the time, and has constantly evolved as life on the islands changed. In some ways, physicists like Huth are part of the next step in the wayfinding tradition, integrating indigenous knowledge with Western science tools to more deeply connect both groups to the ocean. Here's hoping that these efforts help these charts and the knowledge they represent to stick around.